Hey, so we got some great guests coming up. Robin Green and Mitchell Burgess. They wrote 17 Soprano episodes. Also coming up, our man Hesh, played by the great Jerry Adler. He will join us. Peter Bogdanovich, director and actor, played Dr. Elliot Kupferberg, Dr. Melfi's therapist.
We're going to have a special guest and episode for the Pine Barrens, which is, you know, a real fan favorite episode. Steve Buscemi, the great actor and director. He directed the Pine Barrens episode. He also played Tony B on The Sopranos. Nominated for an Emmy as Best Director. Also nominated for an Emmy for his role as Tony B. He's going to join us soon. Annabella Sciorra, who was just phenomenal as Gloria Trillo, Tony's mistress. One of my favorite actresses in the world. Also, coming soon, little Steven Van Zandt, a.k.a. Silvio Dante, will join us on Talking Sopranos.
Plus, we're going to have more actors, producers, cinematographers, more crew guys. Please go to TalkingSopranos.com to get official Talking Sopranos merchandise. All right, guys, stay tuned.
What's up, man?
All is well.
You got your Yankee pinstripes on today.
I got my Yankee pinstripes. Let's see what happens here. Yeah, you know, I'm a Yankee fan. You're a Yankee fan.
I'm a big Yankee fan. Yes.
Well, you've been out of it. You don't even know the Yankees.
I've been out of it on a lot of levels this year.
You're looking. Are you getting ready for a role? I see you got a beard.
No,
happening.
I'm just lazy.
Looking good there. I like it. I like it. But today we've got two incredible guests. Incredible
and very, very important to the development of the show. And the show would not be the success it was without these two people. Critically important to the show.
They were nominated for 11 Emmy Awards. They won three. They also, for this episode, Employee of the Month, they won an Emmy. And they also, your favorite episode is certainly one of them, White Caps. They wrote that one, and that's one of your favorites in the whole series. Yeah.
They wrote one out of five episodes of The Sopranos. They wrote 17. That's a fifth. One out of five they wrote.
And they also created Blue Bloods, which is amazing.
They created Blue Bloods.
You know, most people don't participate in one good show. They've participated in at least three. Also, Northern Exposure. They're a married couple, and they are just fantastic. We had a lot of laughs with them, and we were out. They got drunk with us. They were as silly as we were. Or are.
A bunch of lunatics.
Well, it was good because it wasn't like, you know, like the student and teacher, like you had to behave in front
it
of
it wasn't the, like the bosses and the employee or
no.
the office, the head office, and then the
we were all a bunch of fuck-ups, the whole group.
Yeah.
Let's bring them on, my two favorite people,
Mitchell Burgess
and Robin Green. Come on down, guys.
Here they are.
Hey.
Hello, Steve. Hello, Michael.
Hello, guys.
Hi.
How's everything? It's been a while. The last time I ran into the two of you, I was walking through the village. It's about 5 years ago. And you guys were outside having coffee or something. And I haven't seen you guys at all. And
I saw Robin last year at Via Carota, which is a great restaurant on Grove Street. Our friend Jody Williams, who owns that place and runs it. It's one of the best restaurants in the city. And Robin was there, and we caught up a little bit. She was great to see you. It's good to see you both now.
Mitch, you look very serious, Mitch. You look very serious.
No, Steve, you thought we were crazed fans, I think. We were yelling, Steve, Steve. And you thought, oh, man, you just kept right on booking down the street like we were.
Well, no, he didn't want to be bothered.
Yeah, well, that's his whole M.O. He's very aloof, standoffish. Fans.
Oh, we were some kind of fans or something.
You know, Michael's not the Michael you used to know. We'll talk about it another time. That's all I'm going to say.
I've gotten a lot better.
So just to get started, you know, from the beginning, right? You guys met at the University of Iowa, is that it?
Yep.
Right, you guys met. Did you set out, both of you, to be writers?
But Iowa is known for their writing program, right? University of Iowa. Yes. Yes.
I mean, so when you got out of high school, I mean, was that it? I'm going to be a writer, I'm going to be a journalist, I want to write for TV, or did it just happen?
Well, no, it didn't just happen. I was probably 40 when I started writing TV, but it was the only skill that I was good at it. I was good at it in college, but then, you know, it was the 60s, you become a secretary, you know, you get this job and that, the waitress, I waitressed a lot. You know, I heard Terry Winter's story about how he went for it. I didn't go for it.
No, it was a different, just a different path you took.
I took the hippie path. You know, it was 1967 when I got out of college. So that was.
You had a lot of fun, though, it seems.
I had as much fun as I could. Yeah.
It was 1967, Robin. It must have been a lot of fun. You were going to concerts. I mean, you must have seen every great band of that era.
No, I signed, without a doubt. I signed autographs for people because I saw Janis.
You saw Janis. Where did you see Janis?
In the East Village.
Really?
At the Fillmore or the no?
Yeah, at the Fillmore East.
Fillmore East.
And Big Brother and the Holding Company. That's what I seem to remember. Do you know what I mean?
Right. did you see Jimi Hendrix live?
I think so.
Yeah. Do you know? We told a story. Sirico told Michael at one point that he worked in a club and Jimi Hendrix worked there, and he used to give Jimi Hendrix wedgies.
No, Jimi Hendrix didn't work there. Hendrix hung out there.
Hung out there. And Tony Sirico in the 60s would give Jimi Hendrix wedgies. Do we believe that? I think we do.
He told me that several times. I mean, I think that's way too weird to make up.
A wedgies is something you do with somebody's underwear?
Yeah.
Yes. You pull them up from the back. So it goes all the way up your butt. Yeah.
I mean, it's just too specific. I mean, if he would have said I smacked him around or I kicked him in his ass, I mean, but to give a wedgie is very specific.
Yeah,
I don't know.
So Mitch,
what happened to me is I was in the Army. I joined the Army and I got out on the GI Bill. I went to the University of Iowa. And I was, you know, I wasn't a very good student, but I wrote a paper at this, you know, rhetoric class. The guy said I had talent, and he said, you should go to the writer's workshop. So I went over there, and Robin was my teacher. I was an undergraduate, and she was a fellow, teaching writing fellow. They give the best writers jobs.
So did you get an A?
Yeah, many of them.
I would hope so.
That's what we like to hear.
You know.
Yeah, I didn't touch him until the end of the term. He already had his A.
I don't believe that, Robin. Not after reading your book, Robin.
You know, I was an old student. I was probably 24 or 5 years old. You know, but
and so then you, Robin, you were the first woman writer on the for Rolling Stone. Is that it?
Well, it was. No other women wrote for the magazine, but I believe that, I was the first contributing editor girl on the masthead with all the guys, with Hunter and Joe Esterhaus and all of that, you know.
So, did you know Hunter?
Oh, sure.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah. Not biblically or anything.
No, I'm not asking biblically.
it's not that kind of show.
But you work with Hunter S. Thompson. Were you on assignments together?
I'm not with Hunter, but with Annie Leibovitz a lot. She started off the same time I did. So for from 70 to 74, I was the only female contributor on the masthead. And so I was the only girl. That's why I call my book The Only Girl. Sort of meaningless, but I wasn't the only girl. I was also on The Sopranos, kind of the only girl in the room for most of the time.
Oh, sure, yeah. Absolutely.
Until Diane. Until
Diane. The end, yeah. Until
then
the
end. We left when they, shortly after they came, we were gone. That was a long time ago, 14 years.
So you're a pioneer. You're a trailblazer.
I am a trailblazer, yeah. I didn't feel like a trailblazer. I felt like a mess, you know, but I did what I did.
I saw the documentary recently on David Cassidy, and you're interviewed in it.
Yeah.
The interview, your piece on David Cassidy was really kind of blew up, right? Because he was this teen idol, and then you did this interview that kind of showed him warts and all, and
to be a rock star. He wanted to be taken seriously.
He wanted to be Mick Jagger, basically.
He wanted to be an adult, you know, because he had been this teen idol, and he'd been, you know, but then, you know, that documentary reveals that he, you know, he had a lot of problems, the guy, you know, so he was very vulnerable. I kind of portrayed him as he was. I mean, he asked for a cover of Rolling Stone, and we gave it to him, you know, and Annie got him to take his clothes off for the picture to be an adult, you know, grow up. And so there was a little pubic hair shine, and it really upset his fans who were like 8 years old.
Right.
Oh, boy. Yeah.
But you hung out. You were like, right, you know, backstage and
well, you hanging. Have the, you know, so I was with him for 5 days, him and his mother, you know. And
was it his stepmom, Shirley?
Yeah,
Shirley
Jones? Yeah. And Jack Cassidy was at that concert, too. He filled Madison Square Garden 2 nights in a row.
He was gigantic, yeah. I was a huge David Cassidy fan when I was a kid. I told you that.
You revealed that to me, and it's like so
huge. I thought he was a real, like, well, he was a real rock star, but I thought the Partridge Family was real, and I just thought he was the coolest, you know.
You told me that that's why you got into acting.
I think I liked the idea of being, you know, what fame looked like, you know, but it was very, I was, I don't know, 5 when that was on the air, that show. 6.
I got to know him later on, you know, because he made a bit of a comeback in I just maybe the early 90s. He was starring in a show at the MGM, and he,
that's right,
and then he had his own show with Lon Bronson, who we know, Michael, and
I didn't know that.
He was at the Rio, and I got to know David a little bit. He was doing okay, and then the bottom fell out again on him. You know, he had some problems, and
I think he had some substance abuse.
Yeah, had some problems, and but there was a while there in the 90s. He opened that show at the MGM and kind of sprung back to life. You know, financially and career wise. So Mitchell, once you you take the class, you meet Robin, then what happens to you guys?
We hook up, and then I eventually graduate from college, and then we take out for California. We go to L.A.
Which a thought
I don't know, or how to do it, or we didn't know anybody, and I don't know what happened. Then we eventually broke up, and we went our separate ways, and, you know, and I got into the computer business kind of deal, and Robin wrote for magazines, and eventually, which got a very interesting way she got in the business, television business.
How long were you apart?
I got into television with Robin, through Robin.
I was already in it. Because when we were in college, when we were at Iowa, John Falsey was in our class, my class, and he used to play basketball with Mitch, and we were friends.
Same who John was. He created a St. Elsewhere and
okay.
Almost Grown.
John Falsey, yeah, and Josh Brand. So John had this new show called Year in the Life with Richard Kiley, Sarah Jessica Parker at 16, Adam Arkin, really wonderful cast, you know, and also Eva Marie Saint was in the pilot, but she dies in a car accident, unfortunately, so I never got to meet her. So they invited me to write for the show. That's how I got into, you know, not the Terry way, where I imitated myself as an agent or anything. I just was invited in. That was my experience. And after that, I just worked steadily. And that show got canceled. And the next year, David Chase hired me. Right off his ground.
And how did you meet David?
Okay, it was the 88 strike. And he had a deal, I think, near Ventura Boulevard, maybe Radford, CBS Radford or something. I don't know where his deal was. But we had lunch. So we're in a restaurant. I'm in there first, and he walks in. I'm way in the back, and I see this man walk in, and he's like the most dour person I've ever seen. I thought, oh my God, I'm screwed, you know. He just looked really tough.
That sounds like my audition. I'm not kidding.
Here's what Tony Sirico said. We were filming the some episode in that first year. Tony Sirico said, he said, you know, I've been to college, which means he's in the can, you know, he's been to jail. He said, I've seen a lot of tough guys in there. He said, I saw David Chase. I took a step back.
yeah, he's intimidating.
Yeah, but you know.
And not intentionally. That's just his vibe.
We sat down And within, like, I would say 15 minutes, we were laughing so hard we had tears, you know? Yeah. And that it that continued on for a really long time.
He's got a great sense of humor and likes to laugh.
But we bonded over the fact of our mothers, you know what I mean? We both had the same kind of mother. And that got us to know each other, you know? So he hired me, and what a great year that was, you know, it was great.
And so, and then you wind up on, from there, Northern Exposure?
Well, I had my own show, you know. I had a show that failed, one of these summertime shows. I wrote a show. It was so stupid. I didn't know what I was doing. So then I was free, and Northern Exposure had also been on that summer. And Josh and John, who I had worked for at the show, you know, Year in the Life, hired me for Northern Exposure, and I was there for 5 years. David came on the third year, but he wasn't there those first 2 years. And then I was having trouble at work coming up with ideas, and Mitch had contacted me anyway. You know, we saw each other a little bit over the years, and I was really in trouble and needed help. And he helped me. And actually, the ideas that he came up with, I presented them to the bosses as my own. Mm-hmm. Two of them won Emmys, I think, or, you know, they were just brilliant ideas. They were brilliant.
Here comes Mitch on his white horse.
Oh, my God. Ba-dum. Swept me off.
It worked. It was a good time.
Now, Northern Exposure was a great show. I used to watch that.
What the hell, a really good run.
Yeah, I really enjoyed that. Barry Corbin, how do you wind up right from the beginning? Does David come to you to help with the pilot? Did he help with the pilot?
We had read the pilot in all of its iterations, right, Mitch?
Yes.
We had read the one for network with no swearing and nudity, and we read the other one for, and at that time, HBO was nowhere, you know. And David had shot the pilot. We were in bed one night, and we'd gotten back together again, obviously, and David called and asked us if the show goes, that was in August, I think, would you like to come write on it? And you'd have to live in New York. It was like, that's a no-brainer, you know. So we said,
well, it was a different deal back then because we were, you know, as producers, you get paid per episode. And HBO was only going to be 13 episodes or 12. And we were, you know, we were doing 22 episodes of network television. And like they do now.
So it was some,
whatever, it's a sacrifice, but not too much, because we really loved the script and, you know, and the show. But when we saw the pilot, it was just amazing.
Really. Well, so yeah, David had that screening, and, you know,
I don't think they know about that.
Everybody knew to come and see the pilot because nothing was happening. They weren't picking up you guys, right, until December. So
yeah,
we're at a party of five. And it wasn't a good match. We thought they wanted us to fix the show, but they actually liked the show the way it was. You know, it wasn't a good match. And we were in a story meeting. We were in a notes meeting with the bosses. The assistant opens the door a crack and she says, "There's a Tommy Soprano on the phone for you. It's the night before Christmas." Or something.
That's when we got to go ahead. Tommy was the character's name at the time.
Your deal was
name, yeah. And so we knew at that point we were saved. We said, we'll tell them, we'll call them back. But we knew at that point what that meant. Do you know what I mean? We knew.
Oh, that's cool.
Yes, it was fantastic. Because that first year, we did, you know, we just wrote it in obscurity, you know. Nobody was watching them. Nobody saw it. We were just doing it for fun because it was like, making art.
And we didn't know if people were going to watch. We really didn't. Wow. I mean, I really didn't. And because there wasn't really series. It was Arliss and maybe Oz was just starting, but it wasn't go-to TV by any means.
And the reason that they let us go from Party of Five was because we were going to the Elephant Graveyard. We were out of it, you know. HBO was nowhere pretty much then. And so it was like we were shuffling off to Buffalo or something.
If you go into the minor leagues, they thought.
Yes. So
they didn't care. They didn't care.
They didn't know.
But when we finished.
Well, we wrote all the shows and we filmed them all. And we were just having, remember, Michael? We were just, everybody was reading the scripts, the crew, everybody. It was great when every script came out. When they came out, it was just a lot of fun to read and see.
What was the first episode you wrote on The Sopranos?
Down Neck.
Down Neck, yes.
Young kid, I think.
Down Neck. That was like one of the first. That was number five. I think it was four or five. Yeah.
The Branzulli and
yeah,
and some other. We took the fifth one, I think.
Yeah, but we started off in, you know, David and Oliver Stone's editing room. That's where the first writer's room was. His movie was done. So we had that table, and there were around 10 of us.
Jason Cahill.
Trying out people.
Jim Manis, Frank Ranzulli, you know.
Yeah, the first season, you guys had a lot of writers, you know, as we've gone through.
In L.A., not everybody came to New York to film.
Just me and Robin went to New York. Frank stayed back.
And then as the series goes on, seems like there's less writers, but there's a lot more characters. Season two, season three, the show gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Yes. I mean, I came on the second episode of the second season, and then as we've been going through them, because this is the first time me and Michael have watched the series in 20 years.
Yes. You know? Me too.
We haven't seen them. I don't know. Have you guys been watching them? Probably not. Not
for the podcast, I've been watching them. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, so the writer's room. Now, Michael's described it to me, but what is that like? Good, bad? Did you hate it? Did you love it? Did you?
All of the above.
No, we laughed our heads off.
It's good, but it's rough. There's times
with Ben's. It was very intense.
It was more uptight the first year. I mean, the part in, you know, Santa Monica, because it was like everybody was, you know, nobody was hired, I guess. Essentially, there was a lot of competition or something. It was uptight, when you say, Mitch, the first, you know, in that.
A little bit. I mean, but only, you know, we probably went to New York the first year, you know, the first year probably was six scripts or seven done, completed. We were trying to catch up to do the other six.
Yeah.
So it was pretty intense. And Frank Ranzulli stayed in L.A. and wrote from there. Yeah. And then we just kind of cobbled together. I think we wrote three there.
Just the process is, you know, it's great and it's hard and it's really tough. There's moments, hard. You know.
I mean, you laugh your head off.
But it was fun. Yeah.
They bring lunch in, you know, and you have a decent lunch because David, you know, liked to eat well.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we would get... I forget the name of the restaurant, but it was veal and stuff.
Probably 9 hours a day, you know, with breaks, obviously. But we were there from 10 to 7
in the room.
But in the writers room, how it worked, Michael, is that people, if you wrote the episode, then you follow the, you know, let the writers would be on the set, remember?
Right.
There would always be the writer on the set. So you would leave. Well, Robin went, you know, like employee of the month, she was on the set. She went to all the casting and then all those meetings that you take. And I would take David's shows because, you know, he was back on the
He was doing the writing. Yeah. Oh, so you would be on set for David's shows.
That's when I was on set.
Were you guys in on a lot of the casting from the beginning for the first season?
Not you guys.
Steve came in, we were there. I was there. Were you there?
Yeah.
I remember when you...
I remember Steve.
I was one of those. I think where there were so many people. I don't remember all that many people.
There was, I don't remember you guys in the room, but I remember there were so many people in the room.
I was one of the people in the room, and, you know.
That's very intimidating.
It's horrible.
I thought you knocked it out of the park.
Thanks.
I think we wrote the episode. Well, you had the best, what was your line now? You know.
When I say I'm in awe of you.
I'm in awe of you.
Yeah.
I'm in awe of you. And you, Michael. My favorite line that you did was, you know, after Tony kills Richie, who did Tony kill? You know,
Ralphie.
Ralphie. And you come.
Whoever did this.
And you've taken heroin, you know.
Yeah.
And you came in and you said, "No, I didn't," or something. It's just, you just seemed like you were so drugged up, and it was, you had, I think, spit. You know, there was spittle. It was just wonderful. You were so there. It was
now casting wise, right? So you write the episode, and like this one that we're doing today, Employee of the Month. So you write the episode, and I don't know, 10, 15, 20 people come in to play the rapist.
I don't remember.
All right, I mean, but do you guys, I mean, does David have the final say?
Yes.
But you have a say. Do you say, I like that guy?
Yeah, we all pretty much, we never disagreed, really.
No, so you kind of, it's kind of by vote, but you go.
It's pretty obvious as a writer. You sit there and somebody comes in and reads and you're like, oh, I'm the worst writer that was ever. What was I thinking? That is brilliant. And then the right person comes in and you're a genius. You see, because that's the that's what happens. And so it's just so obvious, you know, and it's
more clear cut than not. So that, you know, sometimes somebody, you know, close, but not really. It's clear.
I mean, but do you have someone in mind? I mean, obviously, when you wrote it, do you have somebody in your head? And then the guy comes in, you go, if this guy can act, he's the guy.
No.
Is it like that? Or you just...
I don't remember doing it like that. I just thought whoever came across...
You don't mean an actor in mind. You mean a character in mind.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, no, not an actor in mind, but just that this is what I see this guy as. He's whatever. And he comes in and you go, all right, you know, no way. This ain't the guy. And then he gives you a great read and you hire him, you know.
You always want to get the best actor for sure.
We just sat there and whatever came in, you know. But it's pretty obvious. I mean, I remember when Janice was cast, I think Annabella Sciorra was considered for that. It would have been a totally different character. I mean, the things set off each other. I've enjoyed so much listening to your actors come on. You know, you guys had so much fun too.
Aida was so good.
But it was a different
Aida was obvious right away.
If it had been Annabella Sciorra, it would have been much different
character. Yeah.
Would have had to write a different character.
She's so crazy, Janice. So crazy. It's incredible how evil and crazy she is.
I know you think she's evil, but they're all
Oh, when she shot Richie, that was pretty great.
Yeah.
There's not a person in the country that could have predicted that. Nobody saw that coming.
Well, we wrote that one too. And in my career writing family television, I never shot a gun in my mind.
You never wrote a shooting
gun. I never shot anybody.
That was a good one. You hit it out of the park, that's for sure. You know what else I love?
I mean, David was great too.
What'd you say?
David was great. Is Richie April? He was.
Yeah.
Oh, God, yeah. I mean, fantastic.
Perfect, really.
Fantastic.
The two of them together was so crazy.
On the couch when they were having sex, and she's saying, "It should be you, Richie." It should, and he says, "That's not part of it."
That's not part of it. Right.
We did that first year. We got back to L.A. Our agent said to us, okay, you've had your little artistic experience. Now you have to get a real job.
Wow.
And so
there's 22 episodes
out of your, you know, body. You're just like, oh, geez.
But nobody had seen the show yet.
Yeah,
and it was just, you know, people thought it was about opera singers and it was like, you know, all sorts of things.
There was a book this thick of alternative titles for it that HBO came up with.
That got lost.
Remember, they wanted to call it Family Man.
Family Guy. Family.
And then Family Guy was coming out, the cartoon, at the same time. and that's why they, you know.
Thank God.
Now, was there somebody you enjoyed writing for, one character more than the other? Anybody that you say, I love... For Janice, I love writing for Tony. Was there one character that you kind of, you know, enjoyed a little bit more? I'm sure.
God, Mitch.
I mean, you know, we kind of, I know people like Janice. So, you know, very familiar with that character. So that was kind of, you know,
Mitch's
easier to do for me, at least. I mean, because the character was just reminded me of so many people I've met, but overall, it was just so much fun to write for everybody.
Edie was fun for me to write for, I guess. You know, I understood her.
Who?
And then Edie would
Edie.
Carmel.
You know, like, we wrote a lot for Janice. There's a lot of things I could say right now that I'm not going to say.
Yeah.
And she said, there's a lot of things I could say right now that I'm not going to say. So you don't always get the way you imagine it, but... You know.
But when it's a good actor, you get something good. My favorite was Uncle Junior to write for. I loved writing Uncle Junior's line. Yeah. He has the lines that could only come from that character. You know what I mean? It's very specific. His
sitting here like pictures.
I mean, that's the whole, but Michael, yeah. That's the whole thing. Only the characters could say those words. You know what yeah. I mean? The characters were so specific in The Sopranos that you couldn't, you know, I've been in shows, you just swap out dialogue.
So have I, you know, as an actor too. Hey, they give you take this, that. You know? Right.
And you're going like, you couldn't do that on The Sopranos.
No, at all.
And it would, because it would just sound like, you know,
of course,
scratching on chalkboard. But yeah, no, you go do this dialogue because this guy can't make it.
Sure.
We never.
Did you get a lot of actors? I'm sure there were some I know along the way that didn't want to say certain things.
That wonderful story with Tony Sirico match, remember? We said he's a bully.
Frank wrote he's a bully.
And Tony called us up and came up or something, and he said, I refuse to be called a bully. And
he said, Paulie's not a bully.
Right. And he said, so Frank chose it to what?
Psycho.
Psycho.
And he was good at that.
Yeah, he was very good on it.
Okay, Psycho, yeah, all right.
You know, not a lot got changed. No, very, very few, you know.
I think Jim has changed something once, didn't he?
I don't remember.
I remember, but I mean, because then you're on the set, they want to change a line, you try to talk them out of it, then you don't want to make that call to David, I mean, about changing of the line. I mean, I had been there a couple of times, I don't remember exactly, but where somebody didn't want to say the line. And I think it happened, I think a couple of actors, when they looped, refused. There was one actor, a day player, who refused to take the Lord's name in vain.
Right, that he was on the wrong show.
And that was the last time. And that's the last time you saw him.
Yeah, no, he was on the wrong show.
I would say this. Most of the time, if you wanted to try a different way or an actor, give what's in the script a shot a couple times. And if you want to do another take, you know, I try to be fair like that.
Yeah.
You know, but we got to have the script.
Mitch can actually act a little bit. I can't do it, but he really understands acting in a way that I simply don't.
Did you work with John Patterson before The Sopranos?
No.
You never did. Did you, Mitch? No.
No.
Yeah.
But he was.
Can you tell us your favorite director to work with, or you don't want to go down that road?
No.
Is there one guy you tried more than the other?
What's that?
Was there a guy that you, I mean, one director that you just enjoyed, you clicked better than with others? And nothing bad. We're not knocking anybody. Just, was there someone, hey, I love John Patterson. I love working with this guy, that guy. Anybody?
I honestly liked them all. Tim, Van Patten, Coulter, Patterson. I mean, and it was very, it was interesting how they each brought a different kind of thing to the Sopranos. It's, you know, because it's the same crew, it's the same cast.
Yeah.
The tones of the shows were ever so slightly specific to those directors. But honestly, I'm not BSing you. I liked them all.
Yeah. I mean, Patterson was a great storyteller.
I mean, especially of the stable, you know, the regular people.
You know. His set, John Patterson's set, could be fun. We were filming Whitecaps. We were down on the shore, Jersey Shore, in this house that we got for the occasion. It was 3 o'clock, you know how it is. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. Everybody's dead tired. And he breaks out, I think I forget what the booze was, but some kind of booze. So now we're drinking. And Jim had a long scene. He couldn't get through it. We kept having to do it. And then we reset. And you know how it is. You have to relight or whatever. All the mishigas that goes with it that I don't really understand. So we did this. And we did it 3 times. And finally, Jim does it perfect. And John says, bingo! And he ruined this take. And so Jim came over to John Patterson, stood behind him, and kissed him on the head.
Yeah.
I mean, when Jim died, Mitch was barbecuing on the terrace. I was in the house. I saw it on my iPad. I went out to tell him, and I my knees.
Yeah.
It was a very, very tough time for all of us. That was just awful, just awful. Was there, you know, the one thing about the show, right? Like, all the actors, we all got along, the writers, the directors. It really was like a family. I mean, we had a lot of fun that can't even describe to people between the Emmys and the SAG Awards and Christmas parties. So we had a party for every fucking thing, you know. And then charity events. You know, we were always together, you know, which you work on other shows. It's like work. You go in 9 to 5, you say hello, you do your thing, you get along, and then you go home. But we were always together. And there was no, you know, like the actors couldn't, because it came from Jim, set an example. Jim was toughest on himself, but he wasn't tough on other actors. He was very supporting, you know.
Well, Mitch got to hang out with him. I couldn't go, you know, to places they went. But, you know, I guess during Nancy Marchand's memorial, they went across the street to some bar, and the bartender lit the bar on fire or something, Mitch? Or?
No, she was showing some crap. Poured a bunch of booze and set it on fire to the drink, which went up in flames. It was pretty outrageous.
You could go out into the night with Jim sometimes, but I wasn't on those excursions.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, you know, when I watch the show, the writing is just incredible. It's just so good that you don't want it to end. You know, as a fan of the show, I just, that hour goes by so fast. It's like, yeah. I never want it to end.
Being that we're doing this episode today, is there any, some like, what's the background behind this Employee of the Month? Where, how did that come about? What was the steps leading up to this going?
I'm going to take that because you were much more involved with it.
But it's a story that you tell a lot. You know, David had this idea that Melfi gets raped, right? And that Jim exacts revenge or has to decide whether or not.
We didn't know what to do, whether he would find out or not.
It was my idea that she doesn't tell him.
Right.
That he doesn't find out. I said, it's more interesting, but the problem with it was, as it turned out, it was an unusual show, and maybe not, because then it was Melfi's show, it was Melfi's story, not Jim's story. And that was, you know, that was a that to me, when all is said and done, it was a different show than The Sopranos in a way. I mean,
it's very effective. It's a good episode and very effective.
It was horrible.
We did a lot of
horrible. Oh no, the scene is the scene.
The night of that rape.
Well, that scene is rough.
She got injured, actually. The guy was maybe she got her arm was just, you know, hurt.
She did. She hurt her shoulder.
Yeah, she did hurt it because he was, you know, it was a physical scene. I didn't know it would be that horrible, frankly. It was like shooting, you know, that you say rape, but the reality was so much worse. It was a horrible night.
Well, the violence.
It's one of the roughest scenes in the whole series.
We did a lot of research on it. We went to that, you know, when they had this hospital down in the village, and we went to a rape crisis center. And I mean, and Lorraine, she just knocked it out of the park.
Oh,
being at the end where the cane falls was all done by, because of researching that and the startling moments of the rape victims.
You know, Mitch has a great story about the episode where Ralphie kills the stripper.
That's another horrific.
We're in the story. Well, that reminded me of that murder was pretty awful too, but we're in the story room and the idea is that Ralphie does something horrible. He kills a dog. We were like, no, he can't.
We're trying to make Ralphie bad, you know, and to act it out so you could see him be bad because we wanted to really, you know.
Cross the line bad to like Tony compared to the other guy.
So we were trying to think of what Ralphie could do to really be bad. And I said, well, you should kill somebody's, one of the strippers' dogs. And David says, you can't do that.
Can't kill a dog. People will.
But you could kill the stripper.
Yeah.
let him kill the stripper.
Oh, okay. Well, seriously, people turn this thing off so fast, we kill the dog. So.
But I kill the dog. I get more flack for that than any of the people I kill.
You caught a lot of flack for killing.
Yeah, still to this day, people are very upset at that. The 20 guys that maybe Christopher killed is okay, I guess. But,
that wasn't that amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was there somebody supposed to get killed that wind up not getting killed? Do you remember?
I don't think anybody was ever saved. I mean, when it was...
Once the decision was made, that was it?
But you know...
I mean, it was shocking the first, you know, when we called Big Pussy the first season, everybody, I was like, wow.
Yeah.
I mean, we're playing for keeps here.
So, Michael, do you remember the first... You know, we used to, David and Mitch and I were out walking. That was a Sunday, I think. And we walked down 7th Avenue. And Mitch and David said, hey, I think Michael's Imperioli has a bar here.
I remember that day.
So it was like you were probably sleeping late because of the bar. You're probably up late. Mm-hmm. And so you heard that David was downstairs waiting for you. And you thought you were going to be fired or killed or something. We said later.
Oh, yeah, I think I was living above, because for a while I was living right above the bar. Yeah.
And you
were a little shocked when we showed up.
You were afraid to come down because you thought it was going to be that meeting.
I was waiting for some big news. It was just, you guys were just hanging out. And I'm like, no, there's got to be, this is way too.
You know, we were visiting, you know.
Yeah, I forgot about that. That's true. Yeah, I was really like, uh-oh.
Yeah.
Or it's, just, I don't know.
I'm out a little.
It was amazing how the actors, we were all really scared. Michael said he wasn't, but I was. And most of the actors were really scared about getting killed off. It was a real concern the whole time, you know.
It was done very effectively. You know, it shocked people and you didn't see it coming. And, you know, the pacing of that.
Was that scene where we kill Richie was, Ralphie, was a big scene for us because... I don't think we'd ever really killed anybody that way.
Wow.
You couldn't write, he throttles him. We had to actually act it out in our, you know, we wrote in this office downstairs in our apartment. But so we choreographed it. But Mitch was on the scene for that one. And when Jim puts his hand on the stove, somebody hadn't turned off the stove. So it really was burned, you know.
The first episode you got the, you won the Emmy for? You won 3, I think, right, for the show?
Well, we have
two writing, I think.
Sopranos, we each get a statue, you know.
No, but we have two writing Emmys. One we shared with David. Employee of the Month was the one we won the Emmy for.
Employee of the Month and White Cat.
Yeah, and then what was the other one? Jesus.
You won one for Northern Exposure, also.
I did.
Yeah. You know, I remember, I think it was the, was it the strike or 9/11? There was one of them where we didn't go out to the Emmys.
That was it. That was Employee of the Month, Steve.
Yeah.
And we watched you guys. We were in a bar. David, you know, HBO, whatever it was, the show, all the actors, we were up there on 2nd Avenue and we watched you guys. Yeah, we watched you guys give the speech. We were going crazy there. It was great.
Pretty amazing. Was pretty funny. We won one with David, I think, with the last, what was the show, Robin?
Whitecaps.
White, it was Whitecaps, yeah.
But if we have 3, I don't know what the other one was.
It was for the show, I think.
Yeah.
Where do you keep them? Where do you keep all your Emmys?
In the apartment in New York.
Ah. Yeah, I think they're in
New York. We may bring them out here. I don't know. You know, it's.
Why not?
I don't know. I think Nancy Marchand made a coffee table out of 4 of hers, you know? She put glass on the top.
Oh, that's nice.
It was a lot of fun going out to LA, wasn't it, though?
Oh, we had a ball. What was there? How many of us? There was 50, 60 of us on planes, limos, drinking in the bar at the Peninsula. What's not to like?
Yeah. It was a lot. Yeah, well, that's when we really got to hang out
and
see everybody.
You guys did a lot more of that, you know, since the show. It sounds like you ranged around quite a bit.
We've done some event, you know, some appearances, and we did a Inside the Actors Studio live theater thing. Steve, myself, and Vinny Pastore, and we did we did 7 cities in Australia last year.
Wow!
Yeah.
And we was
many, many years ago. I was wondering, and I would ask Robbie, I said, "Do you think this thing will last? You know, the 2nd or 3rd season, you know, it gotten big, but they don't always last and live on and on." And I'm just amazed at how many young people come up to me and say, "I just saw The Sopranos." And
it's amazing.
They're 23 years old.
Oh, yeah. It's huge. It's bigger now, I think.
Yeah,
Steve says that all the time. He thinks it's a bigger show now than it was then.
I think more people watch it now.
Yeah.
More people have access to it all over the world. Right now, we have people all over the world are listening. it's very big in so many parts of the world. It's amazing to us.
Yeah, it is amazing.
You know, the Melfi stuff, like in this episode, was that hard to write?
Psychiatric stuff?
Yeah, that stuff.
I have enough experience in that room.
Because it's so good. And I like it so much better that I've gotten older. Back, you know, years ago, I don't think I understood it as much, but it's so good. I
mean, but really, after spending so much time in therapy, now you're kind of getting the...
See, he's mocking me because I've never been in therapy, Michael. But, so he mocks me.
But that was the chemistry.
No shame in it.
He doesn't need it.
There's no shame.
He's well adjusted. He's not like the rest of us.
If I needed it, I'd go in a second.
He doesn't. He's healthy. He's not mentally.
Maybe you need it and you don't know it.
No.
Robin, you're probably right, Robin.
Sometimes I'm his therapist. Sometimes he's my therapist. And then,
Jim and Lorraine were just the chemistry between those two and when they're sitting there together was pretty amazing stuff. I mean, it just it was magical things going on.
So good.
But I heard, you know, when it was Jim's side, because they would do his side second. You said on one of these podcasts there was some. She put a boa underneath her. She sat on a boa, do you know, like a feathery boa. Somebody looked over at her. He was just crying.
I thought it was a braid.
Was it a braid?
Yeah.
Coming out between her legs. Is that it?
It was a hairpiece. Yeah.
A merkin. Maybe it was a merkin.
I don't know. I think it was a braided hairpiece. And she put it, but yeah, she would do that to him. I mean, you know, if you think about it, it's the first scene of the show, of the first episode, is therapy.
Well, is it therapy or the ducks?
I think it's therapy. I think it's the two of them. I think that's the very first scene.
He's sitting there in the waiting room and looking at the statue. Wow.
I got to tell you, 50 years from now, I think people will probably still be watching this the way they watch The Honeymooners and these other shows that are still around. And I think,
That's very, very optimistic of you to think that the world will still be
here. I'm probably trying to make it through next fucking week. I understand. Right? Trust me, I'm trying to be optimistic. It's not easy. Well, thank you guys so much, man. Really, it was.
Yeah, like
spending the time. It's fantastic talking to you.
Okay.
Hopefully, when this is over, we can go out and get drunk again.
Yeah. Thanks for
all right.
I'll see you guys.
Okay. See you in the village.
Okay. Thank you so much. Take care of yourselves.
All right.
There you go, man. That is good stuff.
Good stuff. Yeah. They did a lot of work on the show.
They were great.
Very important. Yeah.
It's so good that I can't even, you know, I can't describe it. I know I'm gushing, but I'm telling you.
All right, we're back.
You like my hat, man.
Now, let me ask you, is that the hat?
The hat. This
Bobby
is the hat.
Bobby Bacala's death hat.
No, I wasn't wearing the hat when I got killed. When Bobby got killed, I was not wearing the hat. I wore this in the garage when he was playing with the trains. I want to say at least one scene, maybe two scenes. This is the real hat. I kept this. This is the choo-choo train hat. He wasn't wearing it in the train.
He didn't wear it when he dies. Okay. All right. He was in the store. He wasn't.
But this is it. Pretty nice, right?
Very cool. It's great that you still have it.
One of a kind. One of a kind. Hat.
That's cool.
There you go. I got to tell you, I really enjoy talking. I enjoy talking to all our guests. I really do. Especially that I haven't, as you haven't, seen a lot of them in a long time. I enjoyed Mitch and Robin as I really enjoyed.
No, them. I always did. And I mean, I didn't bring this up. I didn't want to, you know, I don't know. But Robin really was very helpful to me when I started writing on the show, just because I hadn't written television before. And she just kind of really explained, you know, the difference between, I had written a couple of screenplays, but never TV. So, you know, besides the spec script. And she just kind of explained how the concision of it, because it's, you know, it's not a long, it's not 2 hours, you know, it's an hour. So the scenes have to go, you cut out quicker, you get into it quicker, you know, and
very
how that
difficult,
works.
Very difficult.
She was great with me. I'm very indebted to her.
That's also probably her teaching, You know, she was a writing teacher, and I'm
she's,
sure
that's she's very, out. You know, they're a good dynamic because you see how she said, you know, Mitch would come up with these great ideas and then they would write these things. You know, Mitch is a very creative guy. I mean, they both are. They're a good team. Good both team. Really, really smart. Really, really smart.
And people. A lot of fun, man. No. I mean, they've always been a lot of fun. Good, really good people. I always enjoyed. I remember we went to eat, a bunch of us. I don't think you were there, but we went to Little Italy and Cortile and we had a great meal and we drank and laughed.
Mitch knows more about wine than maybe anyone I know.
Really?
Yeah, especially French. I mean, Italian too, but he knows the year, the great, you know, the house, the chateau. I mean, he is an expert.
Wine expert. Nice.
Really, really knows it though. Knows his shit big time.
Yeah, I thank them for coming on. You know, I get a lot of questions now. I'm sure you do too. People go, how do you remember all those lines? What do you do? Like there's some magic potion to it, like, you know, which is far from the truth. Because if there was a potion, I would pay anything for it. I mean, learning the lines, some people have an easier time than others. You got to work at it. I mean, you got to put the work in.
For me, it's just repetition. You know, I mean, I do, you know, I take the page, I hide the other line, my line, and I read the first line, and then I do. Some people tape other lines. Yeah. I've never done that. I can't do that. I don't usually read with other people unless I'm on the set and I'll go over the lines with the other actor. I like that. Or if the other actor's busy, not available, I'll get someone else to help sometimes. But it's really just repetition. I use weird mnemonic devices. Like, so sometimes if it's technical, you know, if you're doing like a cop show or a medical show, there's technical terms that are hard to memorize. And I'll make up little anagrams with the first letters of words and just.
Yeah, I have a tough
weird
time.
Weird shit like that.
Yeah, I have a tough time. You know, I mean, when I get the script, I look it over, I circle, you know, my stuff. I read it out loud. I think it's important. You know, along the way, I've talked to other actors. I picked up a few tips. Jim used to use index cards. You know, he would have the other guy's line on one side and you know, his on the other. He told me about that. But I use a tape recorder. So I'll learn them and write them. Got to write them. Over and over and over.
Writing helps, yeah.
Got to write them. Then once I feel I know them somewhat, then I'll record the whole scene, and then I'll record the other person's lines. And I just keep on beating it to death. But you got to be careful because it'll dry up on you.
You don't want to be too locked in. You want to know it and forget it, kind of.
You know, right? Sometimes you learn it too much, and it's like you get to the set, you say, I knew this yesterday. I mean, you know, you'll hear that a lot, you know.
Or you'll you'll predetermine how they should be, you know, acted when you know it too much, which is not good either. I like to know it before I go to bed. Right? So then in the morning, I forget. I don't think about it. I eat breakfast. I get dressed. I go to the set until I get the script. You know, I get the sides, the script of that day, work for that day, and then I'll go over it again. But I like to go to bed knowing it. If I don't know my lines when I go to bed the night before, I can't sleep.
I'm with you. I'm in a panic. You know, everybody could blow a line here and there. Of course, that's just part of it because you blow a line for whatever reason. But there's no other way around it except to put the work in over and over. I mean, by the time I do the scene on Monday, I mean, I've gone over this thing, I don't know how many hundreds of times, honestly.
That's what it takes. And I mean, some people don't, you know, for TV especially, it's like movies, you have sometimes some movie sets, there's a lot of improv and, TV is very often, it's locked in. You're an episode and it's based on other episodes like The Sopranos. There's no improv, there's no alteration, there's no variation. You got to know that line and say it.
Well, the thing is that, listen, time is money, right? So if you're wasting, you know, an extra hour on this scene because the other actor or the actor or you didn't know your lines, you cost them money. You won't be around that long. Yeah. You know what I mean?
No, I know.
You got to prepare.
You got to
prepare, prepare, prepare. And that's, you know, half the battle. You know, there's some actors say, I don't want to know it too well. That way it's fresh and all that. You got to know your shit, because I feel when I know the stuff, then I can make whatever adjustment. The director says, you know, do it this way, try it this way. I could, it's like spinning a basketball on your finger.
Right.
I could do whatever I have to do.
Then you have the freedom, you could play with it.
You could work it.
If you're just struggling to think about it, then you're not in the moment, you know?
Edie Falco, and I think I've talked about it, she was able to read the stuff that morning, she told me a lot.
Everybody's different. But do you find, say you're shooting a season of television, right? 8-9 months, you're blue bloods. As the season goes on, your ability to memorize gets better because you're working that muscle more.
Well, I think it's a muscle, sure, absolutely. Yeah. And also how it's written. If it's well written, you learn it easier.
Easier to memorize when it's well written.
Absolutely.
100%.
Because, you know, we've all done stuff that's not great.
Clunky.
And it's sometimes, like, man, it's this clunky. Doesn't make any sense to me, you know, right? Yeah. You go, this doesn't make any sense. How am I going to learn this? But I'll tell you this, it's a big part of it once you're rolling, because some shows, you get a couple of takes and that's it. Sopranos, you had a little time. But some shows, you got two takes, man, and gone.
Yeah.
It's like a soap opera. Moving on. You know, I did a soap opera and they told me, they move so fast that the other actor said curse, so they can't use it. You know, curse or say something that they can't use, and so they'll give you another take. Honestly, you know, like, you know what I mean? Like, so, and then I like the speed, like we did, where you do no emotion at all, just back and forth, just a line, blah, 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 blah. And then we were doing the movie Stewie, and the director came over to us and said, oh, it's got to be much slower than that, guys. That's not how you're going to do this. We're fucking rehearsing.
We're
man.
Just learning. Yeah. You do that in theater a lot. They call that an Italian, which is the actors just sit and do the whole play or like a chunk or a scene of the play really, really, really fast.
Just fast. You know, so and you don't even think about it. It comes out of your mouth. You want to know the text so well, it just comes out of your mouth without even thinking.
Yeah.
Because if you got
that great documentary they made about Apocalypse Now, called Hearts of Darkness, right? And there's a scene when Coppola is directing Dennis Hopper. And Hopper, I guess, is in the middle of, I mean, he probably was on God knows what drugs. He's kind of out of his, he's playing a crazy character and he's out of his mind. He doesn't know the lines and Hopper's trying to explain, I don't want to know the lines so I could be spontaneous. And Coppola's like, no, you learn the lines so then you can forget the lines. You know, and Hopper's like, no, man, I just want to know, you know, and it's that whole. And Hopper's amazing in the movie, but God knows how they got to that, you know.
And like place. I said, you don't want to think about it, you know, you just don't. You know, that's, listen, you know, I worked early on, I was in Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. I had a little scene with Benicio del Toro and Johnny Depp. And I did not know this at the time. I was very green. I think it was 1997. We shot at the Old Ambassador Hotel in L.A., and there was a guy feeding Johnny Depp the lines in an earpiece.
Mm.
And I didn't even know that existed at the time.
People have done. I've heard Brando did that. I hear.
Yeah, Johnny Depp was being fed the lines. I don't know if he was drunk or high or acting it. I don't know what the purpose was, but they had a scene and whatever the guy said it, however the guy said it, that's the way Johnny Depp said it.
I guess because he was doing Hunter S. Thompson, who we just mentioned in Robin's interview, who she worked with at Rolling Stone. I couldn't work like that. I can't. I mean, I remember I told the story on the podcast, the scene in the fish store with Lilo Brancato and Chris Tardio, and I had not slept and came in hung all kind of a mess, and I didn't know the line. I couldn't say the lines. They put cue cards, and I couldn't do it. I couldn't read the cue cards and act. It was very distracting, took me out of the moment, and I never let that happen again because it's not fun. I mean, if you're not in the moment, you're not doing the scene.
The fucking pressure. You don't know your lines. Plus, you know, you got 200 people on the crew. 100 people, 150 people, and you're going to make a jackass out of yourself. It's happened to me. Not for not preparing.
No, it happens. That's how you learn.
Remember the scene, which we'll in one of the episodes coming up. I couldn't get the fucking line out. Joey Pants was breaking my balls. Remember that? In front of the pork store?
I do, yes.
I couldn't fucking get the line out. And when I learned it, I knew I was going to fuck it up. I couldn't get
the line out. You got mad at him that day.
I got really mad at him.
Yeah.
And I was really mad at myself, not at him. But he was laughing at me.
He didn't help.
No. All right, man. Let's take a break.
All right, we're back. This is season 3, episode 4, Employee of the Month. First aired March 18th, 2001. Of course, written by Robin Green, Mitchell Burgess, directed by John Patterson. A very controversial, a very memorable, a really difficult, hard, tragic episode, you know?
Yeah.
And it's one of the episodes that really illustrate, I think, this episode, the Pine Barrens, and the finale really exemplify something that David had in mind, you know, in his philosophy. I'm going to read a quote by David here. If you're raised on a steady diet of Hollywood movies and network TV, you start to think, obviously, there's going to be some moral accounting here. That's not the way the world works. It all comes down to why you're watching. If all you want to see is big Tony Soprano take that guy's head and bang it against the wall like a cantaloupe, the point is, Melfi, despite pain and suffering, made her moral, ethical choice, and we should applaud her for it. That's the story. Which, I mean, it's very specific to this episode, but there's something in there that also, I think, relates to Pine Barrens and the finale in that, you know, if you're raised on a steady diet of, you know, Hollywood movies and network TV, you expect resolution.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, listen, certain shows, you know, at the end of it, it's going to be wrapped up in a nice tight bow. They're going to get the bad guy. They're going to get the killer. There's going to be revenge. And that's frustrated a lot of Soprano audience.
It frustrated people in this episode. But I think that what he's saying is the important thing is Melfi makes a certain moral choice to rise above it. And all the people who complain about the Sopranos was this or that and it glorified this or that. Well, this is one of their, you know, this is an Emmy winning episode, one of its most important. And it turns that theory upside down, really.
Yeah. I, you know, they wanted to know where the Russian was. That's the big question. They want to know about the ending, like you said. You know, is he alive or dead? And it's not wrapped up in a bow, you know. Listen, also, there was I remember years ago, a Soprano fan said there should be killing every week, and if not, at least a beating. I swear to God, that's what this guy said.
For some, so
you know, you want to see that shit, put the news on. There's beatings and killings
every
moment, unfortunately.
I mean, look, well, Sopranos had a very broad audience. Some people like the kind of action, gangster, B-movie type of noirish appeal or whatever. And other people like the family dynamics, the psychology of it, you know, the complexity of it. It appeals to a very broad audience.
Well, there was something for everybody.
Something for everybody, yeah.
Some people didn't like the violence. Some people didn't like the cursing, you know, the sex.
The therapy. Some people weren't interested in that. You know, they found that to be kind of too intellectual or whatever.
But like I said, people are still talking about all this stuff, you know.
Yep.
All these years later. So there you go. This was directed by the great John Patterson. This was 6 of the 13 episodes he directed. And Mitch and Robin, this was the 7th of their 17 episodes. So Lorraine Bracco was nominated for an Emmy for Outstanding Actress in a Drama Series for this one. And this episode was submitted and she lost to Edie Falco.
Close one.
She was great. Lorraine was really head and shoulders.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this episode, her performance is scenes that she's just magnificent.
This was a brutal one to watch.
Yeah.
Brutal episode to watch. Okay, we're going to start the Soprano living room. Tony's in his bathrobe. He answers the phone once again. I don't know how she gets his home phone number. It's Irina. You know, I miss you so much. He says, are you drinking and dialing? And she says, my cousin doesn't have her leg. Obviously, yeah. Janice stole the leg. They still can't find the president.
They can't find it. And she wants what she wants from Tony, Irina. She's, you know, she's not over him, obviously. And she wants, is she in love with him? She's hooked on him.
And there's a flat out product placement. What do you drink? I could smell the Stoli vanilla.
Vanilla vodka, Stoli.
And then you see the bottle.
And that's flat what out, she's drinking.
Flat out product placement. Melfi's house. Melfi and Richard are making dinner. Richard, her ex, they're back together. I want to make this statement about Richard. He reminds me of Cusumano, Dr. Cusumano, well, who I don't like. It's the same. They're cut from the same cloth.
Is he a doctor as well, Richard?
Yes.
La Penna. So they're both doctors. They're Italian-Americans who, you know, rose, you know, in society to prominent places and made some money and upstanding citizens. And
very smug, very condescending, very
very well played, though. The actor,
No, of course. I'm not.
Richard Romanus, who also.
I'm talking about the character. I didn't say Richard.
No.
Richard Romanus isn't smug, but.
No, I know that. But I know what you're saying. I think he plays him really well and honestly. So they're back together. He's the father of Jason, right?
Yes.
He's Jason's father. They were married. They split up. Now that they're back together. He's older than Jennifer Melfi.
10 years older. We find out. Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's still hung up about this. You know, he doesn't like the mob thing, which is kind of a mirror because during the show, we took a lot of heat from that, right?
Well, in this scene, he says, talks about, you know, the National Italian American Foundation is boycotting ABC's show Gangster.
Yeah.
Which he calls the stereotypical Goomba Fest.
Bad Goomba Fest. he doesn't like, people think he's a gangster because he has a vowel at the end of his name. They make assumptions.
Right. She says, we're an ad for the American experiment. The Italian Americans, you know, she's basically saying, look at you. You're a doctor. You're an ad for like the American dream, which, you know, some Italians seem to think that they represent that.
Yeah, but you know,
and they do to some extent.
But you know what? If you're going to be that ignorant, you know, that to think that everyone who's Italian is in the mob.
Yeah.
And shame on you. It's like saying every black guy is a rapper. Every rapper is a gangster. I mean, you're talking real fucking ignorant.
Yeah, absolutely. That's my argument all the time. I mean, if you know, I think the audiences are smarter than that. That's why these Italian-American or anti-defamation of this or that, they're not, you know, they're not giving the audience the benefit of the doubt, saying, no, they know.
Exactly. You know, this is a small part of Italian-Americans that are in this world. It's a very small percentage. He keeps bringing it up. You know, the doctors, but, you know, listen, years ago, growing up, doctors could do no wrong, like with your parents. Doctors, teachers, and priests. And we come to find out years later that that was all bullshit. But if a doctor said something... Not all. No, of course not. Once again, but if a doctor said something years ago, my mother and father took it. The doctor said it. The teacher said it. The priest, he said it. And he reminds me of that smug, fucking condescending guy. That's all. All right. Melfi's office, Tony. He compliments her. You look good. Is that you? She says, did you bring your log, which they talked about? She wanted him to write down his feelings of anxiety.
He forgot about it already. You know, she says, you know, you're not really trying. He's talking about the past. Yeah, I don't want to deal with the past. I got stuff in the present. My son, he doesn't try hard enough in football. Like, he deflects. Tony deflects, you know, he doesn't really, you know, he got somewhere in the last episode. He doesn't really want to go there. He wants to talk about what he wants to talk about sometimes. Very often, actually. He's a manipulator.
And there's a breakthrough also. You know, he had a breakthrough in the last one. He says, my mother's dead. I haven't had a panic attack. She says, well, you had gone months without panic attacks, you know, before. So that doesn't mean anything. He doesn't want to talk about the past, like you said. And he says they indulge AJ. The two of them, him and his wife, they indulge AJ, whatever that means. And Murphy tells him, you're not trying.
Right.
You're not trying, like you said. Elliot's office. Richard was right. I've been charmed by a sociopath. Because Richard's been on her, her ex, to get rid of Tony Soprano. You know, he knows who she is. Richard knows it's Tony Soprano. He saw it in her daytimer. She blurts his name out.
She blurts his name, which she's not supposed to do. And he says, oh, I thought it was that Augie April, who I don't know who that is.
I don't know who that is, but
it's an important scene here for her because it, if you track this scene and the end, where she goes with her relationship to Tony Soprano and through her, this tragedy that, you know, happens to her and her feelings around it, by the end of this episode, she comes to a different appreciation for Tony and understanding of and kind of compassion for him. We'll get into that as we go.
She said that she rejected her husband, Richard. He's 10 years older for the same reason she married him, to protect her, right? You know, he knows it's Tony. It was a big no-no. But Elliot says, so if he was just a button man, I like that he uses the lingo, right? If he was just a button man, would you still be treating him? But because he's high up. Richard knows he's high up. And he's been on it. Get rid of this guy. Get rid of this guy. Get rid of this guy. So that's what she's going to try to do.
Right. And he's saying that, you know, you're attracted to the fact that he's so important. He's in the news and that makes you feel important or whatever it does. And he's saying, hey, listen, for anxiety disorder, psychotherapy is limited. You got him on the meds. He's doing okay. You know, you've done some insight. He's gained some insight. But now he's got to go to a behaviorist to really deal with, you know, to make progress.
Olivia's basement. Fucking Janice. She's using a metal detector.
And what is she trying to find?
She thinks there's money buried. Don't you remember Olivia in season... as soon as we saw Janice, is that season two?
She thinks there's money, Olivia
says. She thinks there's money. Olivia said in front of the doctor, in front of the nurse, remember? She said that she had money. She had told her to kind of bait her. So she's... got a Geiger counter. They still call it a Geiger counter.
A metal detector.
Metal detector, Geiger counter. Jeez.
Geiger cactus radioactivity.
All right, so she's. It shows you how much I don't know.
That's all right. I get it.
She changed the locks. Tony knocks on the door. Usually he can get in. Svitlana. Because she don't want Svitlana to come in. And she's looking for the money. She tells Tony she's doing a documentary, World War II,
and
their music.
And he goes, the records are a window into mom's soul. And, you know, she's just it's money. I mean, it's probably, like we said, a couple hundred bucks. Tony knows he's just full of shit. And then she accuses him of, well, you do the same thing. You're going to get contractors in here to tear down the walls. He says, you're looking for the lost Dutchman's gold. Now, Tony Sirico and his brother Carmine apparently went on an expedition looking for the lost Dutchman's gold in the Superstition Mountains in Arizona near Apache Junction.
Really?
Did you hear? When Carmine moved out there near those mountains, the Superstition Mountains, and Tony and Carmine went looking for the Dutchman's
gold. Tony told you this?
Tony told me it was immigrant named Jacob Waltz. They call them Dutch because Deutsch is German, but they said Dutchman. He wasn't Dutch. He was German, but he found a mine. They found this guy dead with big packs, mule packs of gold, and they knew he found a mine, and no one knows where it was, and they still don't. It was over 120 years ago.
So Tony and his brother went looking for it.
Apparently, they went on an expedition looking for this lost Dutchman's gold, which may be worthy of a movie.
And it what, just because it's Tony with the wings out in the desert?
Looking for the gold? I mean, it must, that would
be. He had
be...
a Guinea t-shirt with a fucking miner's hat on the wings?
He told me this story. They went looking. They didn't find it, but they, you know.
I wonder if his helmet with the light had wings on it.
With the light.
She says, oh, I know you're going to get a contractor and you're going to make him knock the walls down to look for it. And he goes, oh, Janice, like. You're so fucking pathetic. Oh, Janice, what are you, you know? You know, yeah. It's a good little moment there. Ralphie and
Jackie Jr., that song Speedo by the Kallax, which is, I think, the first scene you see De Niro in Goodfellas. That same song, Speedo, plays by the Kallax. Good 50s, 1950s rock and roll tune.
Ralphie and Jackie Jr., they eat dinner. You know, they're talking. Ralphie's trying to bond with this kid. He's, you know, he's ogling Adriana. Ralphie tells him, you know, you know, Jackie Jr. is a flat out douchebag.
He's got a very bad attitude and a very high opinion of himself.
And he's not very smart, and he thinks he's smart. And there's nothing worse than a guy who don't know that he don't know.
That is
true. You know that, right?
That is true.
He say, you know, Ralphie says, I'm trying hard here. I'm dating your mother. He goes, dating. He says, you know who? Ralphie tells him, you know, who's a mink? Meadow soprano. So he puts that in his head. He says, Jackie Jr. says, I've known her since we're kids. You know, they're kind of almost like cousins. And he acknowledges, you did a stick up. He says, I did a stick up for money. My mother wouldn't give me money. I wanted to go to South Beach. And I got to tell you, this robbery that Christopher and Jackie Jr. they pulled is the worst kept fucking secret in the state of New Jersey.
Everybody knows.
Everybody knows. How could you not get caught? Everyone knows.
Yeah. Everybody knows. That's true.
So he says, I got to go meet my buddy at the gym. They're driving to the gym. He says, you mind if I take a stop? Make a stop. Ralphie uses this as a kind of a bonding moment with him, right?
Bonding moment is a guy that owes the money. He, you know, and they rough him up. They beat him up. And it's the beginning of a weird... Ralphie starts talking about how Jackie Jr. will fuck the guy's wife. And, you know, it's the beginning of a weird... Ralphie has weird sexual things going on. And Jackie Jr. picks up on it at some point.
Yeah, and he also... he provokes this guy, the Arab guy. You know, he's provoking him. The guy, you know, he's not happy, but the guy's not causing any problems. But he gets it so bad, the guy takes out a bat. They beat the shit out of him. You know, this, to me, Ralphie... can't get through to Jackie Jr. And this is his way of doing it. I got to make a stop. Come, let's beat the shit out of this guy. We'll take his wallet. Gave Jackie half the money. This is like kind of a bonding moment. This is like the mafia version of playing catch with your girlfriend's son.
The right? Batting cage. Instead of taking him to the batting cage.
Exactly.
You're going to go beat up a guy.
Beat up a guy. We'll steal his fucking wallet. We'll provoke him. This is that moment. This is how Ralphie, the sick fuck, is going to bond with Jackie Jr. over this.
That's pretty funny.
You know, Johnny Sackshouse.
Denise Barino Quinn. This is a great story, who plays Ginny Sack. This is the first time we see Ginny, I believe. She was one of the people who attended there. And in 2000, they did an open call. They advertised it in the news.
Yeah.
Harrison High School. Over 15,000 people showed up at this. An open call means anybody. Most auditions for Sopranos, you go through agents, SAG actors, managers, professionals. An open call means anybody could show up. Over 15,000 people showed up, came from different states. People came from Wisconsin, Delaware, all over.
They had to close streets down. It was crazy.
It was supposed to be from 10:30 to 3:30. The police shut it down at 10:45. Only 5,000 people got in. They took an additional 7,000 headshots, and only one person got a speaking role out of all these people, and that was Denise Barino Quinn. She was a legal secretary. We lost her. She passed away at the, you know, way too young at 46. She was a sweetheart of a lady and did a great job as Ginny Sack.
And she wore a fat suit, just so you know.
She wore a fat suit.
She wore a fat suit also.
She did a really good job, but they may have got some extras out of that call. I don't know. Yeah. I've done open, when I started out as an actor.
Really?
I would get Backstage magazine, newspaper, and they'd have open calls in that. I went to an open call. Once in a while, they'd have big movies, because I wasn't in the union when I started.
That's tough.
Movie called Five Corners. John Turturro, Jodie Foster, Tim Robbins. I forget who directed it. maybe Tony Bill, somebody like that. And they had open call for that. And I waited all day. It was up by 50, near Studio 54, 54th Street, Broadway. All day long, you're waiting, sitting on the street all day long, hours. I mean, there's hundreds of people. And I got in, and they brought me back the next day and read for the director, and almost, I came very close to, I think Carl Capitordo got the part I auditioned for.
Wow. Carl, who played Little Paulie.
Little Paulie. But I used to do quite a few of those things. They're not fun. They, you know.
No. Wow.
For the Soprano open call, people came dressed as, like, you know, guys and dolls, guys in pinstripe suits with the white tie and the black
machine
shirt.
Guns,
oh yeah, they had props,
machine guns,
fake cigars. People came with hats. It was a, it was on all over the news. And you know, this is 20 years ago, but this, that's how we got Denise Barino Quinn onto this.
Yeah, show. She was a sweet lady, is right, and she did quite a bit of episodes. I don't know exactly how many, but she was a. So he knocks on the door. He's got a gift for them. This is Johnny Sack's wife. He comes in, he brings the gift. It's a big, huge, beautiful house, which, if I'm not mistaken, it becomes Bacala's house later on and Janice's.
Oh, really?
I think later on.
I think
on,
you're right, yeah.
You know, Tony is annoyed. Johnny Sack did not tell him that he was moving to New Jersey.
No, and he just saw Johnny Sack and Carmine Lupertazzi at the making, you know, Christopher's being made ceremony. And Carmine was a little bit doing a little power move with the you know, being in the psychiatrist's care. And maybe Tony's thinking they're pulling a move on him.
And I think maybe they are. He also says, hey, don't forget, I already had the condo in Point Pleasant.
That's so different, though.
He's saying, I already have roots. Point Pleasant, obviously, is down the Jersey Shore, down south. Tony's not happy about it. It's very obvious to me. She did 17 episodes, Denise.
17 episodes.
A lot of episodes.
Big part of the show.
Yeah. Where the pizza store, outside the pizza store.
That's Lodi Pizza off route on Route 46. Another good pizza joint in New Jersey.
Good?
Yes, it is. Yeah. Still open.
So here comes Ralphie as Furio, and Tony pull up. Ralphie gives him a package of money, hands it to Furio. He tells him a bad joke about light bulbs and how many knobbly dons does it take to screw in a light bulb. He said, you could use it. Furio says it doesn't translate.
The light jokes.
Furio is a very funny character.
Yeah.
Very funny character. He's a mean, tough guy, obviously.
Serious,
but,
too. Yeah.
But he's got some very funny lines. Very funny. Ralphie tells him the bad joke. And here comes Tony, gives him the bad news that he's Gigi's the new captain.
And Tony's mad at him that he took Jackie Jr. to beat this guy up.
And he's mad that he beat the guy up, period.
He's mad that he beat the guy up. He's already mad that Jackie Jr. was with Christopher. So this is not good because, that you know, he's supposed to be looking out for him. And he wants to keep Ralphie down. He's making a point of that. He knows Ralphie's a problem. He's got to keep him in check.
Well, he tells him he's got bad tendencies.
Joe Brooklyn. He's doing something with Joe Brooklyn. I don't know who he, who does, who
I don't
that,
know who Joe Brooklyn is, but obviously he's a New York guy. It sounds to me. So you got Johnny Sack.
Right.
Also, he says, I had dinner at your place. He plays that card. He said, this is business, Tony tells him, you know. And Gigi is now the man in charge.
Captain, yeah.
Melfi's office. I think you're ready to move on. She's going to dismiss Tony now. You're ready to move on to behavior modification therapy. What's that mean? You're going to pawn me off on somebody else?
Yeah, he feels betrayed.
But she backs off right away. I'm just introducing the idea. Yeah. She backs off. She gives Tony, she says she's going to give him some material to read.
Yeah, and he's, you know, he's a manipulator. You know, you asked me to get serious. Now when it's hard, you pawn me off. But she's actually saying something legitimate in terms of his growth and what he may really need. But he's, you know, I mean, it's tricky. You get used to people, I guess, in therapy, and you trust them. You don't want to leave. You feel you're making progress. And
But you're getting into this. I mean, he's going to therapy for his panic attacks and the root cause of it, right? I mean, he wants to get help. That's why he's there. But sometimes, I mean, there's people in therapy for fucking 40 years.
With the same problems.
I just read Chris Rock says he was doing 7 hours of therapy a week, 7 hours. I just read that in the Hollywood Reporter. It's a lot of therapy.
It's a lot of therapy.
As long as it's helping, it's fine. Yeah. But is it helping? That's the $1 million question.
That is the question.
I think I would have made a good therapist.
Yeah, I agree.
Cut away all the bullshit. You need to solve your problem. I can help you solve the fucking
problem.
Sometimes
you help me. I go to you with issues and problems. You help me. You're a good sounding
boy. Let's stop, because you got to kind of stop. A lot of it's just bullshit around it. Let's cut through some bullshit.
Yeah, that is true.
Parking garage.
This is the rough. This is
a very difficult
one
scene.
Of the hardest, maybe the hardest, roughest scene in The Sopranos. This and the murder of
the,
Tracy,
the dancer. Absolutely.
Dancer. But this is somehow, it's very, it just shows the crime for what it is. It's about anger, it's about hatred and violence. And it's they shot it in a very effective way because
I mean,
it's Mario Polite, who's a sweetheart of a guy. You know, he's a very good guy. He's a lieutenant in the New York Fire Department for many years, I think.
Yeah,
still
I don't
is.
Know if I've ever met him. I don't know.
Yes,
if
I've ever met him. Has done a lot of acting. He's recently in King of Staten Island with Pete Davidson, the Judd Apatow directed film. He was also in The Deuce, Crashing. He was in the movie Hustlers. He's done a lot of work, but he's still a lieutenant in the fire department. Really good guy. Playing a really terrible guy in the show. It's a horrendous scene and very disturbing. And
Murphy's on the phone with Richard, her ex, her husband, and so she's talking. And he's saying, "Did you get rid of him? Did you get rid of him?" He's badgering her about getting rid of Tony Soprano. Did you do it? And she says, "I'll do it, you know, when the time is right." Because obviously she floated the idea and then backed off. So she's a little distracted here, right? She sees him going up the stairs, goes to the car, grabs her from behind. You know, I see once they go back into the stairwell, that's Lorraine. You can see it's one camera. And you see it's her. And it's a really brutal scene right on that stairwell. It's tough to watch. I forgot how tough it was to
watch. It's really tough to watch.
And he rapes her. And it's and then there's that overhead shot where she's alone on the stairwell, and it's horrifying.
Yeah.
Then at the police station, Richard arrives. Melfi, she's banged up. You know, he hit her. He banged her up, her face. She's beat up. She really screwed up her knee.
The son arrives. They turn, found out the guy's name was Jesus Rossi.
So he's saying Italian. I thought he was Puerto Rican. That means something to this Richard. Instead of just, it was a fucking guy who raped your wife. Right. That he's Italian is a big stinger for this fucking.
Somehow, yeah.
Jack off of a fucking human. And he's not very, I don't find him that comforting to her. I think he could be more comforting. You know, I don't know.
Maybe that's why their relationship had so many difficulties. Yeah. I mean, of course he's in shock. I can't imagine going through anything like
and
that.
And so she could identify him. She said they caught him. The son comes in. He says, give me 5 minutes with these. He's obviously upset. Give me 5 minutes with these motherfuckers. The world is a bunch of animals. It's a sewer. No truer words are spoken.
Is that? Yeah, yeah. No. Wow.
And this is 20 years ago. And he's getting away with it. That's the hard part. That's a tough one to swallow.
And that happens, unfortunately. Yeah.
The Soprano house.
Melfi's calling her patients. She calls one patient and says, I know talking on the phone upsets you, which, you know, was a, it's oddly specific line. Carmela's not so thrilled to talk to Melfi, it seems. She's...
No, but nicer than last time, I think.
Yeah, but not very nice and not very, you know, Tony wants Carmela to join him in therapy. She's kind of skeptical. She's, you know, it's not like, hey, yeah, let's do this. This might help our marriage. She's not rejecting the idea, but she seems very, to me, she's very standoffish and skeptical of Dr. Melfi. That's my opinion. That's what
she's probably jealous because Tony bangs everything with a pulse.
So you think she's still maybe thinking he's having an affair with her?
She can't trust. She doesn't trust Tony for one second.
But she knows he's, listen, he has prescription meds that are given by
a doctor. You can't go to the therapist and Schirripa. Could still happen. She doesn't know. She knows that she can't trust her husband. Now, so she says, I got to cancel the appointment. She's cordial enough, Carmela. Tony comes down. Who ate the last piece of cake? She's on the phone with Melfi. One of those soprano lines that have no meaning except real life. Open the refrigerator. Who ate that last piece of cake?
Yeah, and how high stakes and terrible things are side by side with the very mundane, simple things.
And she tells him, you know, your therapist had a cancer. She got into a car accident. He says, why don't you just announce it on, WFAN, which is a sports radio station here in New York. He tells the maid, who he does not like, go find some dust.
He's not a fan, no.
He tells her, go find some dust. And he's a little too concerned about Melfi's well-being for Carmela's taste.
She's suspicious, yeah, I guess.
And you're the right. Knee, oh my God, she gets, and he's going, and the knee, and you get stitches in the knee, it's never the same. It's like Joe Namath and arthritis. And I got to tell you something. Here's this powerful man who runs this crew and this New Jersey and a murderer and all these
crew
things.
Of killers, yeah.
And his wife makes him like he's backstepping and backpedaling, you know, here. He got in a little deep. He's saying, showing too much concern. She's not having it. It's amazing to watch him shrink.
Yeah, yeah.
This 6'1", you know, 250-pound guy is shrinking, you know, right in front of our eyes. Melfi's house. She sleeps on the couch. Richard arrives.
She's really suffering. She's in bad shape, mentally and spiritually and psychologically and physically. She's suffering.
You know, Richard walks in. He wants to know if they called yet. Did they call yet? He calls up. The one female cop that was on the case got moved to juvie. No one told them. He's talking to another cop. Said that it was filed up by the chain of custody. That even though she identified him and they got him and they know it's him, there was some technicality. They had to let him go.
Misplaced evidence. Yeah. Yeah, the way the evidence was handled, they had to let him go, and there's no recourse, it seems. The case is dead because of the way they handled the evidence, which is, and that story-wise puts in the mind of the audience, okay, they're not going to get justice through the legal system. Next stop, Tony Soprano.
You know, she's violated again. I mean, she could identify the guy. She wants to talk to them. He curses at the cop. He says he's going to call his attorney. And then they have an argument. She says, you blame me for this. And he doesn't deny it.
She was alone in the parking lot. She should have the security guard, but it wasn't late at night, you know. And then she kind of says, I was distracted because I was talking to you, telling me to get rid of my client. And she says something interesting. Any misdeed by an Italian somehow damages your self-esteem. But this is the first, I think, for me as a viewer, the first inkling, okay, maybe she's going to get Tony Soprano to, you know, write
the first of it. Sure. You know, the thing that got me when she said, you blame me for this. And he said, well, I've told you a bunch of times, you know, have security walk you out when it's late. I mean, what kind of line is that? She kind of takes a swipe at him.
Yeah.
You know, she can't move closer. She takes a swipe shot, you know, and he can't believe that an Italian did this. This is a Puerto Rican, yeah, but Italian would never do this, you know.
You know, in Goodfellas, the girlfriend of, so Lorraine plays Karen, is the girlfriend of and then the wife of Ray Liotta's character, Henry Hill. He's having an affair with Janice Rossi.
Yeah. You think that has something to do with it?
Maybe.
We should have asked Mitch and Robin. We missed that.
Who auditioned Gina? That's Gina Mastrogiacomo. Mastrogiacomo.
She passed away young, didn't she?
Did she pass away?
Oh, yeah. Many years ago. Andy, look that up. Many years ago.
She auditioned for Janice. Yeah. She actually came close to playing Janice, I guess, her and Annabella. I did not know she passed away.
Passed away a long time ago. Yeah. She was
very good in Goodfellas.
Yeah. The Bada Bing. The crew at the Bada Bing. They're counting money and, they're just hanging around like they usually do. You got Paulie, Silvio, Gigi, Tony, and Furio is there.
And they start in on Ginny Sack. This becomes a whole episode about insults to Ginny Sack and the
some
weight.
Good jokes there. You know, her blood type is Ragu. She wants a bigger house.
She needs her own zip code. Yeah, it's pretty.
You know, when she hauls ass, she's got to make two trips. And who walks in? Johnny Sack. All you people talk about is coos.
Coos. Well, I don't know.
That's an odd choice.
Kind of. Does he hear? Does he think maybe they're talking about his wife?
I think maybe he does.
Gina passed away in 2001. I didn't know that. I'm really, really sorry to hear that. She was a really good actress. Great. Goodfellas, and very sorry to hear that.
So they're coming up with all the jokes. He also told Gigi says Ralphie told him that it was his idea to make him Gigi captain. You know, he had to spin it, to save face.
He had to spin it, and now it's like Tony's thinking Ralphie's talking to Johnny Sack. What does that mean? Ralphie's a wild card. Ralphie's bitter. Ralphie's angry. He's talking to Johnny Sack. Johnny Sack says, turn on the TV, and now we have... This is going to become a storyline, a running thing about this Esplanade project, which is to transform the waterfront, which is a shithole, and turn it into something with condos and movie studios and parks. And Zellman, played by Peter Riegert, the assemblyman, he's making this happen. He's connected to the mob. He's going to give them the contracts. They're going to make a lot of money. They have a lot of potential. They call it, Paulie calls him a busted valise.
Broken down valise.
You use that. Broken down valise. Calls him a busted. Tell our viewers what that is.
A broken down or a busted valise is, a guy with no money. He's broken down. He's got no dough. He's kind of a shitbag,
A shitbag. Yeah.
Kind of a shitbag. He's on the take. He says it's worth it giving him kickbacks just for the drywall contracts. You know, Zellman is a corrupt politician. And
he's in there. They got him in their pocket.
So all this money coming in, $25 million, they want a piece of this. They toast. This is probably why Johnny Sack has moved to New Jersey.
To oversee this and make sure that the New York family gets
their piece of the pie. My favorite Ginny Sack joke, when she goes camping, the bears hide their food. I like that one. You don't like those fat jokes. She was wearing a fat suit. It's okay.
I don't think they're that funny, actually.
Well, give me a good one. Give me a good fat
joke. I don't know. I'm not a comedian.
These are mobsters in the back of a fucking strip club. You think they're going to be brilliant material?
They would say stuff like that. It is true to the world.
It's not going to be brilliant material. Man.
No. It's not Jackie Mason.
Tony splits wood in the Soprano backyard.
Well, before that, we're in Melfi's bedroom.
Oh.
She's lying in bed. Richard walks in, and he's really angry. I want to go find this bastard. I want to kill him with these hands. And I could and I would, but I can't. They put me in jail, and she knows that. And the cut is from Richard's hands to Tony's hands with an axe, splitting wood. You're making an obvious distinction between these two guys. You know, he's chopping a log, and earlier in the scene, he brings up, she asked him, did you bring your log? I don't know if that's the... And there's what he's doing with the log. He's splitting it in half with an axe. You know, the contrast between these two.
Tony splits the wood. Chris comes in. You said Satriali's at one. He says, now you know how it feels. They move into the basement. because Tony thinks it's safe there to talk. It's still being bugged.
It's being bugged. Chris apologizes for bringing Jackie Jr. on the heist. He says Jackie Jr. did a good job. He was only the driver, but he did a good job. And he was not a problem, not a hothead. He kept his cool, but Tony's still pissed. And it's interesting because he says, you know, I was told to watch out for Jackie Jr. Don't let him get involved in this thing. And then Chris is like, but it's okay for me. And Chris feels bad. He's like,
I think Chris is looking for a little pat on the back also.
Oh, but he just, it's like, okay, so this guy is worth more or means more that he shouldn't be involved in illegal, dangerous activities, but it's okay for, you know.
His nephew, yeah. But
and he explains he's not like us. He's, you know, he doesn't have it in him.
You and say, Christopher says, he's good. He did a good job. He pissed his pants. Besides that, no cowboy shit.
Right. What did he say? It's good enough for me, but not Little Lord Fuck Pants, which the feds think that might be somebody's nickname.
Yeah.
It's a kind of a tender moment between Tony and Chris, but kind of a weird moment because Chris is like, he likes the affection. He likes Tony saying, Tony says, I love you. And, you know, he's not like us. We're different. It's a bonding thing, but Chris is also a little bit like, wow, so you're protective over this kid, but me, you know, you're willing for me to be in any kind of trouble or danger or something.
Yeah, like that. I hear you, but I also think Chris is older than him, and Chris wasn't born with a silver spoon like this kid. This kid's father had a lot of money. Jackie, sure, was the boss of the family. They still probably have a lot of money. Wasn't Rosalie Aprile giving money to the priest and shit?
Oh, yeah.
So she's flush. I think Jackie's father left them in pretty good shape.
A lot of money.
Nice house.
He was the boss. He had a lot of money. Yeah.
Chris wasn't raised that way. Chris's father was a broken down gangster, and the mother was an alcoholic.
And he died. And he died young. He left him, you know. Yeah.
Correct. Parking garage. This is where Melfi is going back to work, which is amazing that she's going back so soon. And she walks in the stairwell exactly where the rape took place. That's got to be tough.
Well, I guess she doesn't have much of a choice, or she wants to face it and just not, you know, get, you know.
I mean, Richard should have took it. If she wanted to go to work, Richard should have took her to work.
Or she may have said, no, I want to do this. Yeah. Maybe, you know, she maybe felt it
she's
was
she's walking with the cane. She's really, really banged up in the office. Tony, what's the other guy look like?
Yeah, and again, we're set, you know, the audience is led to believe here maybe it's going to come out. She looks beat up. She's going to tell Tony this is what happened. This guy's, you know, and no, that's not where we go with it.
No, but that's where the audience is rooting. The audience wants Tony to kill this guy.
I think I did too.
They were on the edge of the seat. They want this guy. Tony also says, Jesus, what's the other guy look like? Which that's the guy's first name.
Ah, right. That's right. I didn't realize that.
Okay.
Very good point.
Melfi's talking about anger, revenge. He says, Tony says, direct your anger where it belongs. And she gives him the reading material. Feel the fear and do it anyway. So she needs Tony Soprano more than now, more than ever now. She feels, you know, he's there. How do you get the people to do what you want? He asks.
Right.
You know, how do you get people to do what you want?
Yeah, it's interesting. How do you get people to do what you want? She brings up the behavior therapy. And he's like, that's what's wrong with this world. An innocent person is driving along and some asshole comes and smashes into them.
No. A Soprano house. Jackie Jr. is borrowing the big coffee pot. What do you call it? What does she call it?
The samovar is more for tea. Yeah, usually.
Samovar.
Yeah. The Russian teapot, basically.
Oh, is that what that is? Okay. You know, Jackie to Tony. I heard about Ralph Cifaretto that he got passed over. Probably a smart move.
He's just out of line in the house.
Who are you?
Carmella's there, you know, you just, it's just the wrong move every step of the way.
I mean, he tells him, don't make this hard on me. I got enough problem with my own kid. Stay out of the business. He's warning this kid. I have one son who breaks my balls. He's warning this Jackie Jr. way too patient, as far as I'm concerned. Tony's a very loyal friend to Jackie Sr. and his wife. Because this kid is so out of line in this world, it's not even fun.
If he wasn't Jackie's son, he wouldn't put up with any of this shit. Not
Meadow me. Comes in. They flirt. Big hello. She says, come to the city, we'll do sushi. Very rude to the father. I need to, doesn't even say hello. I need $200. Ba, 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 ba. They mention about Noah being under the covers. Jackie Jr. says, don't worry, I won't tell anyone about it.
Which is another bad move. Just, you know, he's just saying all the wrong things.
I mean, I tell you what, if it was my daughter and that situation came and she came in without saying hello and said, I need $200, I would have said, turn around, get your laundry and go the fuck back to school.
Yeah.
That's what I would have said.
Yeah, I think for it's easier for Tony just to, you know, not deal.
And he braces himself. I mean, he's getting it from it. He gets it from his son, this guy. Gets it from, think about his life. His son is breaking his balls. The daughter's breaking his balls. The wife. He still has.
The guys in his crew.
Janice.
Yeah.
He still has Irina calling. Junior. Oh, Jesus Christ. Who needs this? We're at the fast food restaurant.
It's called Rap Nation. The clerk here, the woman behind the counter, an old friend of mine, Sabrina Guevara, who went on to star in the show Gotham, became a big actress. I met her in 1989 or 90. She was studying at Fordham Lincoln Center. And I had a friend, my friend Fernando was going there. So I pretended to be a student so I could do plays there. And I did a play with her by Arthur Miller called The Creation of the World. And she was maybe 18.
So you were a ringer.
I did three plays at Fordham Lincoln Center Studio Theater pretending I was a student. I was not a student, but I wanted to work.
You pretended you were a student at Fordham.
Yeah, I became friends with a lot of the students, so they just let me act in their shows.
But they knew.
They knew that I wasn't going. I was just still studying, and I wanted to work, and it was fun, and they were good people. And
That's good.
And Sabrina went on to be a big star.
I mean, but that, cool. But it seemed like what you just said, just like what you said and what Terry Winter said, you got to be proactive with this shit. 100%. It's not going to come to you. If you think that you're going to go take your lessons, your acting classes, and then you're going to sit back and wait for the phone to ring, you're going to be waiting a long fucking time, my friends.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, everyone says, I want to act. I want to do, I always thought about it. Well, go out and get it done somehow. Right? I don't know how. I don't have the answer, because if you talk to 100 actors, you got 100 different paths.
Don't know how, but you got to find a way. I always tell people, you as an actor, you got to find a way to act. I don't care if it's school, you produce your own play, you got to find a way to do it.
Yeah, especially nowadays with the quality of the cameras, you can make short films.
You
could write the dialogue, you know.
YouTube. Listen,
look at our friend. We have a friend of ours doing a short film in his apartment with a dog during the pandemic.
That's right.
Right?
You got to find a way to work. I mean, I hadn't done anything. I don't think I'd done any film yet by that point. Maybe just right before, the year before I started working in film, but I wanted to work. I did a talk radio, Eric Bogosian's play, where I played the lead, which is I was maybe movie. 21 or 22. So I got to do that part at Fordham. We did this Arthur Miller play, and we did a David Mamet play, The Woods. So the good material, you got to do it in a theater. And
did a lot of people come see him, see the play?
Yeah, you had people. They had good audiences. But listen, that's how you learn your craft. Listen, you got to get up on stage.
You got to do it. It's like being a bartender. You could read that fucking book all you want, how to make every drink. But until you make one, you don't know what you're doing.
That's true.
I say the same thing.
Yeah.
Melfi orders some food. She sees the picture of Jesus on the wall.
I tell you, this is a really great way to just make this story so complicated and difficult. You know, the idea, you're going in a store and it's not enough that she knows the guy got away. You go in the fucking store and on the wall is his picture and it says employee of the month and there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah.
Legally. I mean, it's a great choice on the writer's part, I think. Really, 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 really effective.
I mean, this is where it comes down to. I mean, you want to kill the guy.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. I mean, you know, karma's a bitch. I did that show for Discovery. And it was about people taking out revenge on people. I mean, there's two ways you can kill someone. One, for me, self-defense, or if somebody hurts someone that I love, a family, whatever, I could fucking do that. I can do that.
Well, you know, crime of passion. Yeah, you get that carried away. It's not calculated or controlled anymore. You lose your anger and your emotions take over. I mean, if somebody hurts somebody you love, I mean, there's... at that point.
You know, unfortunately, you'll wind up in jail or worse. But,
In Italy, there's certain crimes. I don't know if it's still on the books, but there's movies that have been made about it where, you know, if you killed out of like a crime of passion, either you got a very, very light sentence or no sentence at all. Like, so your wife cheats on you, something like this. There was, laws like that on the books.
That's a difference. That's.
I don't know if that's still how it is, but I've seen movies from Italian movies where that Seduced and Abandoned might be one of those movies. That's a good one.
I think in Texas they used to have he needed killing law. He needed killing.
Well, that sounds really scary. I don't know, but basically what I'm saying is it's been taken to account that, there's certain times when you're not in control of your senses. Certain things that make you insane.
Listen, I did a lot of research. There's a million stories about people who just couldn't get satisfaction legally and they took the law in their own hands. And,
and
right or wrong is up to you, but.
And I think going back to that quote that I read of David's at the beginning of the episode, he wants, he chose to make Melfi rise above all that and make, some kind of decision to take this moral high road and high ground and go on from there. And he finds a nobility in that she does that.
A crime of passion for me would be to smack Jackie Jr. around and Melfi's husband. I'd like to smack the two of them around.
And Cusimano.
Cusimano, the three of them. All great actors. They've done a great job. So great
that
it's made me really dislike them. Olivia's house. Janice is playing Satisfaction by the Stones.
He's got no talent for music, obviously. That's not going to work out for Janice.
Oh, she's trying. Russian men break into the house. All the guy wants is the leg back.
She's not given the leg. They hit her and she goes clanging into the guitar. Of course, it's always funny when someone gets hit or bumps into a guitar. You can't not get a laugh when that happens.
She says, "You know who my brother is." And the guy is kind of polite about it. Just give me the leg and we're going to get out of here. Cause the guy don't want trouble either. This Svetlana needs this leg.
Yeah. She could have avoided this.
When she goes to the front door, looks out the window. When he puts his hand through the glass, she doesn't run like in a panic. She just goes to the back door. She's going to slip out because she's so devious. This isn't that foreign to her.
Because she planned this. She knew this might come.
Not that foreign to her.
And then she has it, of all places, another great Soprano detail, a locker in a bowling alley. Which you don't really even see much of the ball. You hear the pins being knocked. I mean, it's just so specific and weird. It's great.
And she says, "Are you people really that callous?" Meaning, Russian people, "Are you really that callous?" And he goes, "You're the one that's callous.
You stole a leg.
Oh, this woman's leg. She's been hopping around for weeks now." Here's the dream sequence. Melfi.
He's putting pasta into a soda machine. Now, she had the soda in the sandwich shop and that's what that relates to, I guess. She's putting pasta in which is Tony, I guess, and or, you know, the high voltage, the danger. She's stuck, like she says that being stuck in the machine is her own guilt at getting, you know, being alone in the parking lot at that moment, whatever that is, and then the dog.
And the dog attacks her rapist in the dream. She puts elbow macaroni in, and then I don't know if that's change. It comes back out.
It comes back out. Yeah, she's paying for, you know, maybe she's paying for revenge. Is that what happens here? Is the dog attacks. She's paying for revenge and pasta. It's related to Italian Tony Soprano and macaroni. I don't know. It's subtle, but it's kind of, they do it, and it's shot really well, I have to say. John Patterson, if that was Phil Abraham as DP, I'm assuming at that point, it's very weird and yeah, very
weird,
creepy and well lit. Well done.
You got Elliot's office. She said, I felt a sense of relief for the first time. I felt safe the first time this happened. He says, empowered. Peter Bogdanovich is really good in this episode also, by the way. The dog, big head, massive shoulders. Who could I sick on that son of a bitch to tear him to shreds?
And a Rottweiler with the Roman legions used this to protect the camp. So it's making this connection to Tony Soprano. Yes.
And no feeling has ever been so sweet as to see that pig beg and plead and scream for his life. I like when she calls him employee of the month, cocksucker. She says it's so eloquent, cocksucker. Lorraine, not like me or you. She says it very eloquent.
Eloquent. Certain satisfaction knowing I could have that asshole squashed like a bug if I wanted. I think that's very important, you know, feeling. And I think it relates to the end of the episode and her relationship to Tony, feeling the fact that she has that power in her. If she wants, and she wouldn't even have to fucking pay for it. If she wants, told Tony, this guy raped me. This is his name. This is where he works. Tony would take care of it.
He would send Paulie. Paulie,
no question. In a minute.
Maybe Christopher.
And she knows that. And she knows that. And there's something she said. There's a power in that. There's an empowerment in that. I think it reflects what happened. You know, it's part of what's her relationship to Tony and how that's going to go on from here. It's important.
The emergency room, Janice is in the hospital. They broke 3 ribs.
And now you have two women who are very important in Tony's life who have both been violated by men, Janice and Melfi.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Janice says, I stole a woman's prosthetic leg, Tony. When did I get like this? She's always been like this. And she'll always be like this. And that's
after
what makes
Richie
this
died, scene, she blames. After Richie died, and it's like,
that's what makes this so funny. Like, Richie died. She didn't kill him. He just died. Yeah. I mean, that's what makes this so funny.
The
he
denial.
Says,
yeah.
You're causing me grief. Now I've got to do something. Tony has no choice but to do this. Otherwise, he looks weak.
He's got to do it. He's got to get revenge.
We've been here before, and you know what it always spells, trouble for the rest of us. She's going to give her life to God now.
There's only one Lord, God. I feel born again in the Lord. And I wonder if that, you know, that's odd too, because Jesus, she's talking about Jesus.
Yeah.
And Jesus was Melfi's rapist.
And he tells her, I told you not to mess with these people.
He brings up Richard Alpert. I guess Richard Alpert was also known as Ram Dass, who was a spiritual leader in the 60s or late 50s. He was at Harvard with Timothy Leary doing those LSD experiments, and eventually he went to India under Neem Karoli Baba, studied under him, and became a spiritual leader, a spiritual teacher himself under the name Ram Dass. I guess he's saying Janice was one of his students at one point. But she's tried it all. Yes. But she says, this is the bottom, Tony. And if it's not, you know, she's had many bottoms.
She's tried all. She's tried to find herself. She's tried to find it all. Johnny Sack's house, big, huge house. They're having a housewarming party. It's on the golf course. Really over the top. Makes the Soprano house look like nothing.
Did you see Paulie had a girlfriend he was kind of fooling around with at the party? Did you notice that?
I did not notice that.
In the house, before they go outside, in the house, Paulie's smelling her neck. I don't know if that means he put cologne on her or whatever he did.
I'm sure he did. I saw Gigi had a girlfriend. Christopher's making out.
Christopher's making out with Adriana. The music is Americano, Brian Setzer Orchestra, Brian Setzer, who we know from the Stray Cats also, but there's some great lines that really reflect this scene. Reach for the stars, grab that golden ring, drive a Cadillac, chasing showgirls, smoking camels, the American dream, which Melfi refers to earlier on, Italians being the ad for, you know, the American experiment. And I think that's why that song is there. And it's a good one, even besides that.
Paulie wants to ask Tony, what do you think? How much you think this set him back? Silvio says 150,000 just for the landscaping. Gigi says, and the property taxes and those you have to pay, as opposed to all this other money coming in where they don't pay taxes. Ralphie quotes Gladiator. You know, he's always a clown. He's a very weird character. He's a Weasley fuck, Ralphie.
He's weird. And there's homoerotic stuff going on with Ralphie, and we'll see that later on. And Gladiator is one of those things.
And he walks off to the side. Him and Johnny Sack get a drink, and it looks like they're scheming. It looks like they're scheming, and Tony watches.
And Tony's not happy.
You know, Melfi's office.
Lorraine is fantastic in this scene. I mean, she's fantastic in this whole episode, but this scene, she really blew me away here.
She is so good in this one, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I was thinking about your behavior therapy idea. Maybe you have a point. If they can help me, he should go there. So he's telling Melfi that maybe I should go. You know, if you say it's going to help me, I'm going to go. She says no.
I mean, what I think is happening is that thing I described where she felt the power and the satisfaction knowing she could have this wrong made right, have this guy squashed like a bug, made her look at Tony in a different light and realize that that kind of power has a certain effect on a person. And I think she relates to him in a different way now, after going through this and realizing that. And there's a certain compassion, I think, and sympathy and respect, I think, she gains for him through this. And she wants to continue working with him because of that.
Well, I think she also has the husband is in her ear about how bad he is and how bad for Italians. I think that's a big part of it. He's been jabbing at her to get rid of this guy for quite a while, as has her therapist. He also has. But especially the husband. And now she's back with the husband, you know. Melfi breaks down. You know, Tony came to terms with talking to someone else. He was okay with that. She says no. She needs him. She wants him in her life.
And he's very tender with her and concerned and caring, you know, too.
And she says, no, we'll do this. She breaks down. He consoles her. What's the matter? Is there something you want to say to me? You want to say something. And the audience at home at this point, I mean, they're just screaming to the TV. Tell them.
Screaming.
Yeah. Tell them. Tell them. And I'll tell this fuck.
Yeah.
You know?
And she says no. Like David Chase said, she's taken a certain, you know, ethical high ground. He made her more moral, ethical choice, and we should applaud her for it. That's the story. That's what David said. And ending on her saying no, quiet ending, quiet music starts. That's Fisherman's Daughter by Daniel Lanois, who also did the end of the episode, Big Girls Don't Cry, when Christopher dumps all his writing, when he's going to quit writing, he dumps all in the garbage. That's Daniel Lanois. That's White Mustang. And this is another song by him. And it's really quiet. Fits the mood really well. Great choice. Great song. Really good episode.
I think Tony, you know, when he's in the office, I think he kind of knows something's up, you know, Michael. I think he kind of surmises, being a street guy, that this isn't just a simple car accident that he banged the knee. She jumped with the cane.
Yeah, and maybe after seeing his sister in the hospital who had just gotten beaten up,
So really, really well done episode. I am going to look into doing therapy for people on the side.
Better help. We'll get into that later. They're looking for, you know.
And who's better than me?
Imagine if you call BetterHelp and they hook you up with a counselor and you get on the line. Can I help you?
What's wrong with that? I'll help you. You could be my first patient.
I've already been there.
You lay on the couch.
I've asked you for a lot of advice.
Lay on the couch.
You've given good advice.
I think Jeff Sussman, our mentor and puppet master, I'll give him some advice. He might use a little therapy. What do you think?
I don't. You know him better than I do.
Okay. Now it's time for the Talking Sopranos Ask Me Anything segment. The winner of our AMA Best Question is Andrea from Los Angeles, California. And we're sending Andrea a pair of Bose headphones.
Andrea asks, and Andrea, I have a feeling you're a Smiths Morrissey fan because of something I saw on your question. So I'll just leave it at that. So we have that in common. Steve and Michael, you are both amazing actors. My first question is for Michael. What was your favorite scene to film with Drea Di Matteo? Adriana, and for Steve, how did you prepare for the fight scene between Bobby and Tony at the cabin for Tony's birthday in the great Soprano home movies? Do you want to go first?
Yeah, so I think I've talked about it before, but I'll talk about it again here. So we shot it in July. We went up to the lake house. It was the first episode of the last nine. And we were supposed to shoot the scene. And then Jim realized that his knees were bad. He had gotten operated, I believe, in the off season, and he could not do it. He felt that he wasn't going to be able, it wasn't going to look good.
He had surgery?
I think he had surgery on one or both, but certainly one. And he said he was wearing a brace, and he said, this isn't going to be right. So we kind of getting ready to rehearse, and we had stuntman there, you know, choreograph and stuff, and Pete Pagosi, the stuntman, and I had my guy and Pete, the coordinator, and Frankie Ferrara, and so we couldn't do it. 6 months later, in January of 2007, they built that cabin on the soundstage at Silver Cup Studios, and it was choreographed. You know, with that stuff, you kind of walk through and you walk through and then you speed it up and speed it up and speed it up. And there wasn't really much preparation. I knew what I had to do. It's not like I got into shape for it, for Christ's sakes.
No, what the fuck? But it's a really good looking. I mean, it looks like a real fight. It's really well done. It's sloppy and scary and, you know, like a real, you know.
We did it was a day and a half. I had hit Jim in the nose by mistake. He really went down. He broke the cartilage in his nose. And I was extremely sore. I mean, I can't even tell you.
Well, you always are when you do this kind of stuff.
I can't even tell you.
And I'll tell you what, you always get banged up. You always get, you do a lot of this stuff, you know, and the kind of material that I've done in my life, you always get some kind of bang. That's why you got to be so careful.
You got to be careful. And it was, like I said, it's choreographed. You spin you around. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to hit you here or make believe it. He's going to choke me at that point. The thing that they made sure of was when Carmella jumps on Tony's back in the scene, if you go back and look at it, they wanted to make sure it wasn't giving Tony a disadvantage. You know what I mean? That she was already off his back and then we were fighting. Because then it would have looked like, well, she was holding him back and then I'm hitting him. So it wasn't none of that, you know? We used the stuntmen very little. Very, very little. And we did it ourselves. So that was my preparation. And I was sore for weeks afterwards. But it was well worth it.
It's worth it. It's really, it's a great episode. But that fight is one of the best TV fights think I've seen. She asked, the favorite scene to film with Drea Di Matteo. I mean, every scene is my favorite with Drea. She's always a lot of fun, and we had a lot of trust with each other and a lot of laughs. as an actor, the scene, you know, when she reveals to Christopher that she's with the feds, it's just one of those moments when the stakes are so high, it'll hold any kind of emotion or choice that you'll bring to it. Because at that point, life will never be the same again.
Yeah.
At that point, you're at the edge of the cliff. And it's just an opportunity to really, you know, go as far as you want as an actor. And we always had each other's back. And,
She was great. You guys made a great couple. Great, great couple.
Yeah. We had a lot of good scenes. That I would say that was my favorite as an actor. But we, you know, anytime I got to work with her was always fun, always a pleasure, and lots of good times. So congratulations, fellow Smiths Morrissey fan, Andrea in Los Angeles.
All right, so Andrew, enjoy your headphones. And listen, thanks for listening. Remember, new episodes are released every Monday. Please subscribe to Talking Sopranos podcast on YouTube, Apple Music, Spotify, Amazon, or wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and like us on Facebook. Don't be shy, folks. If you like us, you know, subscribe and let us know, you know. And right now, you can get official Talking Sopranos merchandise on TalkingSopranos.com or through our YouTube channel.
Our executive producer is Jeff Sussman, soon to be Steve's patient, apparently.
Yes.
Producers Andy Verderam. Music was composed and performed by the great Elijah Amiton. You can hear more of Elijah's music and also the band Zopa, which Elijah and I play in together, if you click the links on TalkingSopranos.com. A production crew includes Eric Desi, Bobby Hutch, Frank McKay, Ty Verderam, Sierra Schirripa. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production.
This was a great episode.
Yeah, good one.
And you take care of yourself, and I'll see you later. Next week.
All right.